what models are made, what are the current options, some instruction sets, operating system, languages, a little bit of. So the PDP-8 was a family of mostly compatible computers sold by Digital Equipment Corporation from 1965 to 1990. It has both 12-bit instruction and data. So bytes are a little funny on it. It was capable of addressing up to 32K words. The last trick is, when I make a statement here, it does not necessarily mean that was the same on every single model. Like the PDP-8A, they did have an option board that would take you up to 128K, but I'm covering what 90% of the machines did to save you a ton of time. It has 8 instruction classes. Some people will call it 8 instructions, but it's really not. The fastest instruction executes in 1.2 microseconds, so we're not even talking in a MIPS here. This was the low-cost starting computer in their product line. So the goal of any of the new models they made was cheaper. It was not faster, better performing, more capable. Yeah. It was cheaper. They wanted to buy the PDP-11 or a Max, or depending on the time frame, PDP-9 or something. When you outgrew your age. And it was the best selling computer in the mid 70s until those little things took over. So, this is the first model. On the left there is the straight A's. And on the right was their reduced cost PDP-8S, where you could pay half as much for a machine with 1/10 the performance. And it was all made out of. These little cards, they had the single, and they also had double wide of those. And that was all discrete transistors. Pointer doesn't work on screen. Diodes. So all the logic was done in the diodes. The transistors were for level shifting and amplification. So my machine has about 10,000 diodes. The next generation. They switched to standard TTL ICs. 8i on the left was the first one, and then the cost reduced model where they reduced the amount of options you could have inside it to get a smaller backplane. I'll just mention the other slash on the prices is the one on the right is converted to current dollars. And it also had to use the same little cards, the same single and double Y, and the sort of see it up there. There's the wire wrap backplane, which is all done, with the semi-automatic wire wrap. So it was expensive to create those backplanes. They have a lot of labor in it. So the next they went to, the cards are now 4 wide, and they're also taller. And the backplane is now printed circuit board, the interconnector. And ADE was the first model. They came out with the lower cost 8M and 8F. One of them is the designation they gave to the OEM version, which has half the size of the backplane. And then the next model was the 8A, where they made the cards even wider again. They're now 6 wide, so they could get more logic on one card and less interconnect. Reduce the number of cards. Then Intercell created in conjunction with DEC, PDP-8 on a chip, a CMOS processor, 6100, which was in the VT78, and then the 6120, which was in the later DEC maze, so that they basically stuck the PDP-8 processor. In the first one was the VT52 terminal and VT100, then they are just basically PC chassis. These became sort of dedicated functions. They they sold them as their WPS word processing system and so on. And they weren't targeted as much a general purpose, and you didn't have the expansion capability to interface to other things like all the earlier machines had. There are also some oddballs, Link 8 and PDP-12, that I won't cover this talk to combine PDP-8 with the link processor. And DEC had clones of the PDP-8. So digital computer controls, FabriTech, and Civic Cyber Metrics made clones of the PDP-8. DEC potentially found some incompatibilities in the digital computer controls ones and modified their protocols so it wouldn't run reliably on their machine. So all these forms go way back. Question?
Yeah, did these clones, I mean, do they come as soon as they're able to use that PDP on a chip?
No, this one here was in the TTL era, the D112. So that was still in the, I think, early 70s, 1970s, was when that was introduced. The clones were in the single chip ones. 1978. So, monitoring phones. So, various people have created PDP-8 replicas for some version of it. The first one was the SPC6120, which used the 6120 processor. They also created a nice front panel for it. Design files are still online, but that one's no longer being made. The current one, the IDP-8 on the right there, is using SIMH on a Raspberry Pi with a nice looking front panel. And I think the Glitchworks, who is here, created a replica of the OSI 560Z, which was where they put a PDP-8 chip as an expansion card for OSI computer. If there are FPGA-based PDP-8 designs online also, if you like playing with FPGAs. You don't need to try to copy down any of the links or anything. Just grab one of these pieces of the paper. So I'll put these slides online. This will give you the URL where we'll be at. So this is just giving you some of the where to find some of these things. The PDP-8 was used a lot for control purposes, industrial, laboratories, universities, and so on. So there are a lot of different peripherals made for it. Of course, the standard computer things like storage, and graphics, and analog I/O, digital I/O, and they even had some options like punch cards and half-inch tape, so you could transfer data to your IBM mainframe for further processing. Line printers, one of the things I brought new this year for my display. And this is just some of the stuff I have. I've got the DEC tape, which is those funny little reels that act like a serial floppy. They're block structured, RKO5s, paper tape, high-speed reader, double type. And the last way you can get your fill of PDP-8s is there are various emulators online, so you can just run them on a modern computer. There's one specific to Apple Mac, Windows, Java 1, SIMH, which is multi-platform, but it doesn't have the front panel and command line. And I also have the ADE that I'll be displaying here. It's normally actually hooked up so you can actually run it over the internet. These are what I hear are the most popular emulators. They're are others out there. Now we're going to move on to the instruction set. The major registers you need to worry about are there's a single 12-bit accumulator with a 1-bit carry, which DEC calls the link. There's a 12-bit program counter. And then there's a 3-bit data field and instruction field that gets you from 4K to 32K that are appended at the top. At the top 3 bits. And if you have the extended arithmetic option, the There's the 12-bit MQ register and a 5-bit step counter that are part of that function. I'll talk a little bit more about that later. So the basic instruction class is AND, which is the AND memory manipulator. Add to complement add. Increment and skip if zero. Use for a loop counter. DCA, deposit to memory and clear accumulator. JMS, jump to subroutine. Jump. IOT, which is input output transfer, that's the instructions are used to control any of the peripherals. And hopper, which is the catch all for all the rest of the instructions that do shifting, you know, clearing the accumulator, incrementing the accumulator, etc. For memory addressing, you can directly address 128 words in the current page, which is based on the current program counter, and you can address 128 words of stage zero memory. And you then, if you need to address outside that, you need to use indirect addressing, where the address you want to access is stored in a memory location that is directly addressable, and then the machine will fetch that value and then use that as the address to actually operate on. And the data field, instruction field register dependent, if you get to the 32K words, there are some special rules, so not everything uses the data field. It's only if you're doing an indirect operation. And there's another weird thing, which memory locations 10 through 17 octal of any page, if they're used for indirect addressing, they will be incremented before use. So this gives you the plus plus pointer of C, if you're familiar with C in hardware for those particular locations. And Core's destructive readout, so it must be rewritten anytime you read a value. So some of these funky things, like these auto-incrementing memory locations and increment skip to zero, come free from time because you're having to write back to the memory anyway. So if you're changing it, you can do that at no additional cost. These instructions, how hard can it be to program? They're missing many instructions that if you're used to the later microprocessors, they're like, where's that? You end up needing to go back to basic math and your Boolean logic. There is no subtract instruction. You only have add. So good. What you subtract is you first have to negate the value. And to negate in 2's complement is you invert and add 1, which is the CMA and IAC operate instructions, which can be combined into a single instruction, which you call CIA. There is no OR instruction. You've only got an AND. But you can use your Boolean logic, and not A and not B is an OR of A and B. There is no stack. Return addresses are written to the first word of the subroutine, then you do an indirect jump to return. Yep. So the 6120, for that reason, added a stack instruction, so they could actually have ROM, but I'm not sure there was ever much use of it. And there's things like the data field, when you do the CDF instructions to change data field, is actually part of the instruction bit. So that is normally done by writing self-modifying code that writes the write instruction to memory and then executes it. So all the things that, they probably don't even tell you not to do these things anymore, but it used to be never write self-modifying code, and all the other things that you'll find in old PDPA code, like this instruction happens to be a data value I'll need. So I'll also use it both the instruction and a data value. And then, of course, when somebody changes the code later, it breaks. So you do find the code is somewhat brittle because it depends on subtle things that if you change it, may end up making it no longer operate correctly.
But you just need 3 words. And it's fully common.
The comments actually are, depends on some of the software, but a lot of the stuff is actually not too bad to comment, although the mindset of the programmer who's reading it is significantly different from somebody who's trying to learn a PDPA nowadays, so they don't necessarily have the details you would like to know. And also storage devices are small, so there is a limit to how much they can count it. And this is the operate instructions. So we increment, clears, complements, rotate, or switch registers for the machines that have the front panel. You could use those as data entry to the machine. So it can read what was on those front panel switches. So we got the way you do conditional code execution is you do skips. So you can do skip of non-zero link, skip of non-zero AC, skip of minus AC, and then also the complement versions of those. So you don't have a conditional jump, you only have a conditional skip next instruction. So then you would put a jump there if you cannot directly make use of that slot. And alt. And there's a whole bunch of rules that are group one and two operate instructions and what can be combined, which I think is a little more detailed if you want at this time. And group three is the EAE, which gives you 12 by 12 to 24 multiply and 24 by 12 divide. And the IoT, you know, the instruction format is 6XXY. Everything you see with a PDPA almost entirely is an octal because that neatly maps into 12 bits. Hex does not. So the XX is the address of the device. Peripherals had common addresses that they would be. Normally there would be either some switch or solder jumpers that you could set the address of that peripheral. But there are various devices that the normal address that were used conflict, so you then have to move it to another address. And the last three bits, Y, is the operation to perform. And that's determined by the peripheral. It can do things like load OR data to the accumulator, skip, transfer the accumulator to the peripheral registers inside the peripheral, or set control bits inside the peripheral. The peripherals can run independently on a PDPA. There's what that called single or three cycle data breaks, which we normally call as DMA nowadays. Three cycle data breaks, the actually uses memory locations in the processor to have the count of how many words to transfer or the address to transfer to, and the logic for working with them is in the processor, which saves logic and peripherals. Is significant, a couple cards to have a register, a 12-bit register. So that was notional savings, although then it took three cycles versus a single one, it was slower. And the memory pass 4K is an option and uses the IoT instructions also. And it also, the PDPA does have interrupts, which also access through the IoTs. There's only one interrupt in the machine, and then you have to go out to each peripheral and say, use the skip instruction IoT for that device, say, was it you? Was it you? Was it you? So here's just a hello world and PDPA assembly. So I use one of the auto incrementing addresses to index the text, so subtract minus one on the address. So we load, first clear the accumulator because there is no load from memory, you can only add from memory. So a common mistake will be accidentally having your accumulator non-zero and when you think you're loading the value. Skip with non-zero accumulator, so if we found the character to print, we'll continue on, if not we'll halt. Then just showing, calling the subroutine. The first word is where the return address will be stored. TLS and TSF. TLS is load the character into the basically the UART and start it transmitting. TSF is skip if the character has been sent. And then the jump minus one just seems it'll just sit in a tight loop until that character has been sent. then I have a clear accumulator and link. Just, you need to worry about that detail like that when you're dealing with assembly. Most machines, and even PDBA, is what registers. I mean, here we only have one. Are modified by the subroutines and which ones are not. So, kind of mention is to clear the accumulator, although there isn't any real hard rules in anything that was done for the PDBA. And then we'll jump I, we'll then do the return. And then we just have the text below. A lot of the stuff is done as 6-bit, which is uppercase only, and you store 2 6-bit characters in the 12-bit word. Takes more slide space to show using that, so I went with a simpler ASCII, which, okay. So now we're moving on to operating systems. Your first option is none. They are a standalone BASIC and Focal. You just load directly on the machine. They also had a Fortran. You could do that way, the assembler, and the line editor. And these would normally been done off of paper tape with something like a teletype. So that would be your program, load device to load and to save your output. Would be punching new tape. They had a disk monitor system, which is usable on a 4K system, and it required either the fixed head EF32 or RF08 disks or a deck tape. And it doesn't work with the later deck tape controller. It's a pretty simple system. Most of the stuff available is a paper tape system. It's rumored to be very slow on deck tape due to the way it's written. OS8 is probably the most popular operating system for the DBA. That requires a minimum of 8K and, of course, some mass storage device. It does have handlers that allow some level of device independence. So that way, it allowed it to be easier to support new disks and so on. They had COS, commercial operating systems, which is mainly being used with the DIVOL language, which is a COBOL clone. They had CAPS-8, they had this weird dual cassette drive that used data cassettes. And these were like normal tape, not the block-oriented like the deck tape. So that was out there. They had RTS-8, which is a real-time operating system that was more intended for industrial control or anything you needed real-time operation. And there are various other operating systems people created, but these are the main ones that I know that were used on the PDBA. And they actually did have multi-user operating systems. So if a PDBA is too spacious or too fast for you, you can share it with other people. TSS-8 was one of the early time-sharing operating systems. The surviving version that's out there requires an RF08, which is a very rare peripheral of the fixed head disk drive, and I've not ever physically seen one. So I don't have one, so I've not actually run TSS-8, although it does run under emulators. Multi-OS-8 was a multi-user OS-8 variant. ETOS, which is,
I was going to ask, I'm not sure I remember myself, but I thought TSS-8 could also run on a DF32, like one user, one disk.
I thought it was too small. It's only 30K words, so maybe you can get it. But I thought I heard that it only runs on.
I'm not sure that's what I was asking.
Yeah, I think that the DF32 is just too small.
But of course, you want to four them on.
Yeah.
Okay, that was it.
Okay. So ETOS, that one requires a special board installed in a DE or Omnibus machine. That one supported both running OS8 and COS. You could run both at the same time. I do have ETOS that was running on one of the machines that was used for school administration. Not everything that works under OS8 will work under the multi-user version. They have some additional restrictions and some architectural issues with virtualization on the PDBA.
Damn it.
the paper tape system, which used either, you know, teletype or DEC also sold high-speed paper tape readers. A real teletype is 10 characters per second. Focal 69 tape is about 8K, so 13.3 minutes just to load the program. And read errors are only detected when you get to the end of the tape, which has a check word. So you can spend 13 minutes and error. Well, rinse and repeat.
Still way faster than typing it in.
Yes. Of course, one of the saving graces is the early machines were all core based, so when you turn the machine off, the program did not go away. So you could just turn the machine on and restart the program, and it would still be there. The high speed reader was 300 characters per second, so no big issue loading the tape from the high speed reader. In general, you repunch tape to correct errors. You know, people sometimes would break them up into multiple smaller tapes, and there are tools that did exist for splicing and patching tape. I am not terribly clear. Some people said this was done, some people said it wasn't. It was really a little bit before my time. So, I mentioned that at the beginning. I am not one of the people who truly used a PVPA back in the day when they were new.
I've seen sticky tape splices, the pre-punched stickies with all the holes punched.
Yeah, I know they did exist, and it's a little unclear on whether those, mainly when you damage a tape, you would fix it with those, or whether people actually tried to patch it.
You would fix a tape, like I got some from Vince to fix a tape that tore in my ASR33. Mm-hmm. I was reading a floating point tape, and it just caught the edge and curled and just long ripped the tape right from the teletype. And what you do is you basically use it like tape, you line it all up on a really good jig, and then you read the tape one last time and copy it.
Yeah. They did have editors, so you would handle the your source and pages, since these didn't have very much memory, so your source could easily be larger than the amount of memory you had on your machine. So you'd read in the portion, edit that portion, write it out to a new tape, read in the next portion of your source tape, edit that portion, write it out until you got to the end. And of course, things like Focal and Basic, they got to fit in memory. And one of the things you may have used paper tape for is backups if you actually did have a disk. OS 8 is pretty primitive for an operating system compared to anything you're used to nowadays. So it provided a command decoder, file system, driver for some hardware independence.
It looked a lot like CPM.
Right.
For some reason.
CPM, or a really stripped down DOS, even some of the names like PIP in CPM. PIP is also a program on the PPA LSA. File names are 6.2. And they only supported 8-year range for dates on files. So their Y2K happened long ago. And they never really fixed it. So they just set it so you could support arbitrary 8-year ranges, but you never really could have an accurate date on a file. And we also had the same issue you ran into on DOS, where devices got bigger than the file system could support. So you had to break them up into multiple logical volumes. Concise Command Language Decoder provides simple forms for running programs. You can just use execute and the file name, and it looks at the extension and determines what program you should use to execute this for the certain subset it knows about. So you do the assembler, start basic, I think, and I think we'll do the Fortran. This is just showing the syntax for like the copy command. You have the output files, You can have more than one for some of the command, less than, and then on the right would be the input files, and then slash is options for the program. So that would be copying two files from deck tape to your system device. And that one, you know, copy command, it goes out and actually really behind the scenes uses the FOPP fireword and the transfer program to actually do the work. And if the program doesn't actually have a CCL shortcut, you can run it, and then you'll get a dot after prompt where then you would enter the arguments to the program. And OSA, most of it, you have to enter things in uppercase. By the time they got to the deck mate, they did support entering commands in lowercase. There's a bunch of commands, create, edit, make, tico, mum for starting editors, delete name, direct directory listing, help. It did have a help facility that could give you limited information on the program. And one of the other important ones is squish. OSA can only deal with contiguous files. So after you've written a bunch of files and deleted files, your free space gets all broken up into small little chunks, and you can no longer fit a big file. So squish will move all your files to the beginning of the disk to give you a contiguous file at the end to create files in the gap.
That took days to run on deck tape.
Yeah, my main thing is RKO5. It's not bad on RKO5. Reasonably fast, yes. And it did have the ability you could store commands to re-execute in these UAUBUC. And some of the programs you add pip, which is a peripheral interchange program. The copy command would only work with, couldn't work fully with non-file structured devices like the paper tape. So you would use pip for interacting with that. It did have a debugger, ODT, optical debugging technique. They did have a batch capability, which is pretty primitive. That you know, would execute programs from a script, and you could specify what the inputs to the program is, but you didn't really have, you know, conditional execution capabilities in it. And the build is what you would use to configure your system and put the drivers in. And OSA provides some support for program. Command line parsing, you could call into the operating system to have it parse the command line for you. And but then you need to do things like, you know, we'll give you the file name and the device that's on, but you then have to call the operating system and say, load the driver to talk to that device and please put it this address in memory for me. And well, if you're wanting to create a new file to write to, it just gives you the size and the start block, and if you have to keep track of the usage and specify when you write what block you actually want to write to. So if you mess that up, you write over other files on your disk, or if you don't check how much what the size was and you write too long, you'll can overwrite files. And then when you close the file, you have to tell the operating system how much you actually wrote, so it would know what size to leave the file as in the directory. And files are only known to 256 words. So the file formats and cells, if you need to know to a higher precision, you have some internal indicator in the file on where the real end is. PAL uses that dollar sign. At the end, say, this is the end of your program, so it'll ignore any junk that ends up after it. Control Z is also frequently used. We're now moving on to languages. You've seen a little bit of the Palite already in that example I gave you. So it's a really pretty basic assembler that does not have terribly much capability, but does provide some functions for you. The parentheses and brace it'll take care of tracking what locations are free, the current page or zero page, to store values and allow you to indirectly address them. And if you do a jump, you can only jump within that 128 words. It will change that jump to you to an indirect jump. It'll also do the same thing for the tab. But bad thing is, if it's an change a direct tab into an indirect tab, the data field now is applied. So it now may not be addressing the memory you think it did after it changes it for you. So that's an easy way to accidentally have your program stop working. Is that memory is now changed, and it's changed to an indirect, which then breaks your program. You do have the ability to assign symbols to the current location or fixed values, and do calculate expressions on them. It does not do much for you on breaking up the code into the 128 word pages you have to worry about. And it does support comments, and like people mentioned earlier, important to do that, because after a little while, you'll never remember what that code did. It's a two-pass assembler, so it can do forward references, and it does have a simple conditional assembly. There's a couple of if conditions, like if non-zero symbol, then whatever is between the less than greater than is assembled. They did have some other assemblers, Sabre, symbolic assembler for binary relocatable program. This was created for Fortran, the one-pass, the operand method, not legal, but it does handle the code crossing pages, and does have conditional assembly, and it has a way of doing externally callable subroutines and linking multiple routines together, and it does provide the code crossing page assist for you. Did have a paper tape system, the CAL 3 is similar to CAL 8. They also had a macro 8, which was a macro assembler, so you could define macros of multiple instructions and then use them in your code. For some reason, that one didn't really get ported into the OS 8 until very late, as macrel, which was used some in the DEC main time. There are also four non-DEC assemblers. KJ is one that's out there that looks to be more powerful than the DEC ones at the time. So it was a commercial product, so back in the day, so it did not appear to get a lot of stuff written in it, or at least not that's seen anymore. A lot of the corporate stuff probably just disappears when they got rid of the PDAs. BASIC was available for the PDA. They had standalone versions. It started with being able to run on a 4K machine, although not very big a program will fit on a 4K machine. So that was more for school and teaching, where you're writing a 10-line program for a class. They have multi-users also for the same reason, for teaching multiple people in a class. And OS 8 graded versions. Not all the versions that we have documentation for still exist. And exactly what portions of BASIC is supported varied some between the various versions. And there are various OS 8 versions that are existing, and there are a number of games that you can out there for playing with it. The variables were letter or letter followed by number. It did support DIM for doing arrays. And just give you the execution speed, I did two nested count to 500 loops for 250,000 total loops, which took 8.8 minutes to run. And I won't bother mentioning any of the links I give. This was a COBOL, which was kind of weird, next specific language. By Richard Perl in 1968. Syntax is completely different, but it's serving the same purpose as BASIC. Line numbers are number dot number, and they use that for determining whether you're executing a single line for doing a subroutine or a group of lines, and a couple other cases. So U is basically more equivalent to go sub in BASIC. Only the first letter of any of the keywords is needed, but all the letters took space in memory. So a lot of things you'll see only use the first letter, which seriously hurts readability. Although, probably if you're an expert vocal person, you got used to reading that. But for people who aren't, it's a little cryptic. And they did have later versions that supported file I.O. for when you're running under a machine with mass storage. The Shang 2 nested loop took 15 minutes. Question in the back?
Cornell used to run a PDP-8 for letting biology students learn about computers, and they ran, this is of course 1970, and they had a four-user focal system. Was the focal doing the multitasking, or were they running four copies of focal under something else?
No, there was a four-user overlay for focal, so that was, they were running a standalone with the special version of focal. Yeah, there's several of the edubation variants supporting multi-users. I have, I think it's like, is it 30 or 25? I forgot which one. But yeah, I have one of the multi-user versions, and I have demonstrated that here in the past. And this is an example of focal. So comment, I think E is clearing memory, A is ask, gets a value from the operator. S is set, F is for loop, T is type, prints out stuff. So this is your standard. Print your payments in program, which I don't need to go through anymore. But it just gives you the feel for the syntax of this language. So how far back in the room can you actually read this? Oh, good. I wasn't sure what size font to use, so I picked a random one. They did have a Pascal. I played some with this. I was trying to do some of the stuff for my demo this year in it. You know, the one I was using is a portable one based on the P4 portable compiler, which compiles to interpreted P code. The error messages and what it prints out, if you get an error in your program that calls it to terminate, are remarkably good for a PDP-8. Huh. So, you know, it has prints out the location, you know, I'm filing a little arrow and pointing to the line with a number, but at the bottom, it gives you full sentences, descriptions of the error message. Just, you know, focal prints out number, number, dot, number, number for every error. And some of the other, I think BASIC prints out a two-letter code for errors. And it also printed out your variables when your program aborted. So it gave you a dump. The dual nested loop with 12-bit integers took 4.3 minutes. In reference, the same loop with assembly is 5 seconds. So I started the code in that, but it was taking 3-4 minutes to do some of the processing, and I thought people may get bored, so I switched back to assembly. I could not find any documentation on the PDP-8-specific changes to the portable compiler. There are some sources with it that you can tell reasonably how to do things, so I was able to figure out how to read a binary file and so on. So, you know, I started to read the data captured for when they're going to do a histogram. But that's where I ended up taking too much, so I stopped at that point. The only supports fixed length strings and syntax if you wanted to play with it. You know, run, P is the PDP-8 binary file. The rest of it for the runtime system. The Pascal compiler is written in Pascal, so you're then telling it to run the Pascal program, which is the compiler, which then reads the next file when actually compiled. And then when you want to execute it, you run p, comma, the file you just compiled p code. There is a Pascal S out there. The version I found, the error messages are in German, and I didn't really have time to play with that one. Some people seem to be hinting that that may be more efficient. I'll just go over some of the other languages. Dival, which is the COBOL competitor, the school administration software on that one of the EPAs I got from Penn School was written in this. There's no test. Huge number of people who expressed fondness for COBOL-like languages. There was a Lisp available for it, ALGOL. I looked at it a little bit and didn't find any PPA-specific material that tells you what the capabilities of it. And from what I can tell, I.O. is not part of the base ALGOL language. It's implementation-specific for the particular implementations. And it appeared it did not support reading binary files, so I couldn't try doing what I was trying to do in it either. And there are other things like Smellball, which is an old text processing language that back in college, and the learn seven languages, do all the weird ones, Snowball, Prolog. So I did play with it some of the day, but it does exist out there. I got a copy of it on my site. We did have multiple versions of Fortran. They had Fortran 2, which is a primitive version of the language that doesn't really look exactly like, if you're familiar with more modern Fortran. Fortran 4 is a little closer to things you may have seen later. It's a reasonable demonstration of Fortran 4. Variable names are limited to 6 characters, and has does. They did provide libraries for controlling some things like pointers and so on. My for loop test, 3.5 minutes. This one compiles to the floating point processor option, so it is not directly executed by the PDPA. And if you have a floating point processor, I suspect this runs really well. For the 99.9% of you who don't have one, it's a lot slower because the PDPA then has to emulate that peripheral. I'm actually check, guys, to see whether they have an emulator with any people in the floating point processor. The Fortran 4 is still the go-to base version of playing Fortran. Later, Fortran has if more block structure, but this one has the. I think I got the next slide. There is a Fortran 2 enhanced, which is a little bit of mismatch. This one compiles to real PPA code, so my nested loops are 3.5 seconds. Integers are only 12 bits in this language, though, which may be somewhat restrictive. It does have reals also. It does have good documentation, which was included with the files I found. And they added the block if and while do's, etc., from some later Fortrans to this one. Okay, so yeah, here's some Fortran. So if go to is, and then I think they also had the example here. Nah. You also had the if go to number comma number comma number, which is if it's less than equal to or greater than, you go to one of 3 different other lines, and the formatting and play through loops of writes and. Give you a feel for language, but it's an hour talk to not let me teach you each language. And the primary editors that were available on PDP-8s were line editors. So if you're real fond for DOS Edlin or something, you'll be right at home. For people who like to actually use the screen for edit, they're a little more restrictive. So when you're using a line editor, you would do things like, first you would use the R command to read in the next section of your file. Now, if you wanted to change it, make it line 17, you would do 14L to list the line and make sure that's really the one you wanted to change. Then 14C, you change the line, so then you could then retype in the new contents for that line. And control form, control L. Would terminate the entry of your new text and return you back to the prompt. Did have the ability to search for characters, where you could then put a change at where the character is found instead of retyping the entire line. And using escape, which deck called alt mode, you could also do search for strings. And Q, right file and exit. So gives you some of the basic capabilities. It had some more. Yes.
Tico was stunningly powerful.
Next slide.
But looked like six slide, okay.
I really haven't found one that I want to use for significant editing. I tend to edit on the PC and transfer it. Yeah, gee. So, Tico is edited with a powerful macro language, like your basic instruction tests that you may be referring to. That was handwritten. Yeah. Also. That may be the copy I have up on my side.
Chase the lights and all that.
I don't think it has a chase the lights. It has an increment the accumulator, so it'll count up.
Okay. But it was actually handwritten.
Yeah. Hmm. So those modeling programs were useful because PDBAs were reasonably reliable, but they did fail more than modern machines. So these little toggling programs would help you figure out what was wrong with your machine.
Do you have any sort of diagram or what have you that has to do with the interface between the PDBA that you host on PDBA and online and the real world outside?
I thought the board schematic I did put online somewhere linked to. I can double check. But yeah, if you want me to. Write me a little note, and if you want me to, I can find where I put that, or if I never actually got around to it.